Praise the Lord, everybody.
Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord, everybody. Oh, come on, let's praise the Lord, everybody. Amen, 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 amen. Minister Gordon about preaching that today. I was ready for some more of that. Well, Monday is my day. Today we're going to take a walk or look at Jesus' last week, his life on earth, his last week with his disciples, his last week of being about his Father's business. This is the week when everything that has been said or done comes to an end. It is this week, from Sunday to Sunday, that people call Passion Week. Well, I've been given the enormous task of speaking about the first day, Monday. Everything that happened early Monday morning set the tone for the week. The event was the cursing of the fig tree. As I read and researched and read and researched and played Who Wants to Be a Millionaire and phoned a friend, I found out more information about figs, and I can't wait for Jeopardy question about figs to answer that question. But it became quite clear what Jesus was doing. Jesus got poor performance for a promise. And when that happened, he wasn't happy at all. The fig tree in this lesson teaches us about the judgment of God on the nation of Israel. Israel had rejected Christ. They had rejected the Messiah, the Messiah. They rejected the Savior. And there was a price that was paid for that rejection. The cursing of the fig tree, in essence, is a warning to all people. It is a warning for us to know that Christ is examining our lives. And in his examination of our lives, he's looking for real spiritual fruit. When he finds fruit, we're blessed. If he doesn't find fruit, there's a high price to pay. Jesus and his disciples traveled from Bethlehem back into Jerusalem. On his way back, Jesus gets hungry. The Lord, the Savior, needs something. The one who created the world now needs something from the world. How can this be? He's God. But he was put in this world to live as a man. One commentary put it like this: the one who made all things now becomes dependent on the things he made. But now, how many of us know that God doesn't need to depend on anyone or anything? Why? Because he's God. God doesn't have to or need to depend on anyone. Remember the sign? Through storm, through rain, through sickness, and in pain, I can depend on God. In fact, we can depend on God before we can depend on anything else. We can depend on God when we're not all that dependable ourselves. God saw the fig tree from afar. His eyes were fixed on the fig tree. He knew it was a fig tree. After all, he's God. He made it. He made everything. Not only did he make the fig tree, but he ran the rivers into the seas that watered the fig tree. Not only did he create the fig tree, God set the sun in the sky that dressed the fig tree. Not only did he create the fig tree, he formed the world in the palm of his hands. in.
Yes.
God has provided everything needed for the fig tree to produce fruit. At this time of year, the fig tree was only supposed to be producing its first fruit. Its little fruit.
Yes.
Small fruit. Sweet fruit. Pleasant. Tasty. Jesus was expecting and depending on the fig tree to produce. Oh yes, Jesus was expecting to find fruit. He found only leaves. There was no fruit. Let's quickly pause for a teaching moment. This is different from the barren fig tree.
Well,
the barren fig tree had nothing. No leaves or no fruit. But the fig tree looked as if it had fruit. But on closer examination from Christ, there were only leaves. Remember, Christ was hungry. Christ wanted fruit. He knew he could get fruit from the fig tree. The fig tree held a promise of fruit. But on a closer look, the fig tree gave a poor performance.
Well,
Jesus spoke and said, "Let no fruit grow on henceforth forever." The fig tree withered away. Could I or you be this fig tree? When it's time to produce fruit, will we be ready? Will God only find leaves? You see, leaves and fruit signifies the life of a tree. But leaves only can tap the strength of a fruit tree. St. John 15 chapter says the leaves are pruned from the tree to give the fruit strength. If we are this fig tree with only leaves, what type of leaves would Jesus find on that tree?
Come on now.
Remember, Jesus is looking for fruit. Instead, he finds leaves of sin. He's looking for fruit. Instead, he finds leaves of bad habits. He's looking for fruit. Yet he finds leaves of worldliness. He's looking for fruit. Yet he finds leaves of laziness. He's looking for fruit. But yet he finds leaves of pridefulness. He's looking for fruit. He finds leaves of unconcern. Jesus is looking for fruit and he finds leaves of hate. Are we putting too much energy into how our leaves
come on.
Especially from a distance, it already has a promise. The promise is that we shall produce good fruit. Luke calls it the fruit of repentance. Galatians says, in order not to be cursed like the fruit tree, we must bear fruit of the Spirit. God has promised us what he's looking for. The fruit of love, God is looking for. Yeah. He's looking for the fruit of joy. That's what God is looking for. Yeah. The fruit of peace. That's what Jesus is looking for. He's looking for the fruit of long suffering. That's what Jesus was looking for.
Well,
the fruit of gentleness. That's what Jesus was looking for.
Yeah,
he was looking for the fruit of faith. That's what Jesus was looking for. Looking for the fruit of meekness and temperance. That's what Jesus was looking for. Remember, if we were this fig tree, the tree that only produced leaves, what would Jesus do? Was he looking for fruit? Would he only find leaves? The tree was cursed and withered away. My question to you today, my brothers and sisters, unlike this fig tree, I want to ask you, are you producing according to your promise? Will Jesus find only leaves on your tree? Will you be cursed? Or will Jesus find good fruit? And will you be blessed? God bless you, my Father's children.